Wants the Fields Medal in 1978, and Terence Tao, who wants the Fields Medal on 2006. It's very interesting to mention that Jean Bourgain, one of the famous Belgian mathematicians, also was and who was a prolific mathematician, had a close relation, personal relation and mathematical relation with Stein. Let me remind that maybe all of you knows that Bourgain won the Fields Medal in 1994. So it's curious because both mathematicians passed away in 2018 with a difference of 2 days just. So Stein is the father of one of the more interesting ideas in harmonic analysis, which is the theory of singular integrals. And this theory is the predecessor of the theory of pseudo-differential operators. Which is the theory that I will discuss today, that the theory about that I will make a short introduction today. So let me say it also that in Ghent we have a very active research group on differential operators. In particular, on the left you can see a picture of mine with Julio Delgado and Michael Ruchansky discussing some of the final details of this paper that I recommend you, if you want, for example, to see some relations between representation theory and the theory of differential operators on non-compact Lie groups. For instance, in this case, in this talk, I would like to discuss the relation between the representation theory of compact Lie groups and the theory of pseudo-differential operators. Also, there are a big theory in the case of non-compact Lie groups, but today I will just concentrate in the case of compact Lie groups. So, to start with my talk, I would like to start making some historical comments about the theory of differential operators. I took this historical reference from this green book that you can see on the left, A Panorama of Pure Mathematics by Jean Didonet, one of the members, who was one of the members of the Bourbaki group. And then in that book, or which is a very nice reference, for example, if you want to see historical comments about not only differential operators theory, but also other branch of mathematics, I strongly recommend that book. But about the historical comments that I can make today about I can mention today about the theory of differential operator is that this theory born in 1965 with the mathematical effort of John Kohn and Louis Nirenberg, two big mathematicians working in the idea of partial differential equations. And then another big mathematician was making contributions to this theory. This mathematician is Lars Hormander, who won the Fields Medals in 1962. Hormander wrote a very famous book about the theory of differential operators in 1985. That you can see on the left also a picture, the analysis of linear partial differential operator, that I recommend if you want to read a background, complete background on this theory. That is very important and also that make this theory very important is that the theory is not used only in partial differential equation, but also can be used in other ideas of mathematics, like algebraic topology. And that was the case of Michael Atiyah and Isadore Singer, who've used the theory of pseudo-differential operators for computing topological invariants of manifolds. So Atiyah for this and other works in topology, differential topology and analysis won the Fields Medals in 1966. Okay, all these are historical comments, and now I would like to continue with one algebraic motivation, because I would like to present this motivation to you, maybe which I think could be nice. The motivation is to introduce the theory of the differential operator. Of one of the motivation is to solve partial differential equations. If one is not familiar with the language of partial differential equation, just let me say that you can start fixing one smooth manifold, and let's denote C infinity M the space of all smooth functions over M. So please fix one differential operator over M. If you are thinking, for example, in one Riemannian manifold, you can consider the case of the Laplacian, for example. If you are consider the case of one Riemannian manifold, you can think about the central differential operator on one Riemannian manifold, which is the Laplacian associated to one Riemannian metric. So let's assume for one moment that you want to solve this inequality, this equation, where P is your partial differential equation, your partial differential operator. So if you have this situation, then the question is how to solve this equation. It's a natural question in analysis or in partial differential equation. So the answer is okay. If you have two cases, for example, if, for instance, assume that you can find one inverse for the operator. Inverse in the sense that this operator, this operator P, is a continuous linear operator, taking smooth functions into smooth functions, and assume that you can find one inverse for this operator. This means that you can find another operator, which you denote P inverse, that also is continuous from between C infinity and C infinity, in such a way that when you make the composition of this operator on the left and on the right, you obtain the identity operator on the space of smooth functions. If you have this, then you can solve the equation, because then the solution for your equation is this one. Is this one that I will emphasize here in yellow. But this is, in general, not the case of the theory of differential equations. Usually, you have one partial differential operator, but this kind of operators doesn't have an inverse. Example, for instance, if you take, for example, the case of Rn, and you take the case of the Laplacian on Rn, which is the sum of squares of the partial derivatives, then what P inverse means here? Yes, for instance, this operator is not well defined from C infinity to C infinity on Rn, in the case on Rn. So to solve this kind of problems, or to find the inverse for this kind of operators, one introduces the theory of differential operators. I will mention how to introduce this this later. Okay, please let's continue with this motivation. You are in the case in which you want to solve this partial differential equation, where P is one partial differential operator, U and F are smooth functions. For instance, if you can't find an exact inverse, like I mentioned in this plot, if you cannot find one exact inverse, like in this case, then maybe you can find an approximate inverse, and this is the kind of motivation that one has when working or when introducing the theory of the differential operators. But then, please let me emphasize something. If you have one differential operator of order m, then you know that the differential operator has this form. This is a linear combination of derivative of some order. And if the top order is m, then you will say that this operator is a differential operator of order m. But then the question is how to compute P inverse. Indeed, in the case where P inverse is a continuous linear operator, like in this context. The question is how to compute P inverse, the inverse of one differential operator. In some cases, this inverse exists, but in other cases, this inverse doesn't exist. But at least, just let me say that one can use for computing inverse of differential operators, one can use the Fourier transform. And this is the main tool in the theory of pseudo-differential operators. And why this is the main tool? Because in local coordinates, if you fit one smooth manifold, any continuous linear operator acting between a smooth function in local coordinates, the operator admit one representation of this form, one integral representation. In this integral representation, for example, if u is a smooth function, you can represent the operator in integral form using the Fourier transform of the function u. The Fourier transform of u is defined in this integral way. But in this representation, you can notice that appear one function here, because you are evaluating the operator in one function. In this integral representation appear the Fourier transform, but also appear one fixed function, which is this polynomial. This polynomial here, which is a polynomial in several variables, represent in some sense the operator. For this polynomial, the associated operator is P, which is the partial differential operator under consideration, which has this form. So you can see the similitude between these two objects in some sense. The object on the right is a polynomial in several variables. Here I am using the multi-index notation. C with the power alpha is just this product, this polynomial in several variables, denoting psi, one point of an n. And you can see that then P is a polynomial of several variables, but on the left, you can think about P like a polynomial, but in partial derivatives. Okay, so in some sense, this representation here in integral form for one partial differential operator allows to rewrite one operator in terms of the Fourier transform of functions and also in terms of one fixed function, that is the polynomial associated to the partial differential operator. In this context, then, when you compute the inverse, which is the motivation, how to compute the inverse of partial differential operators, when you compute the inverse, in local coordinates, you have this kind of representation. you have this kind of representation. This is the motivation. You have the inverse of the operator. If the inverse exists, admit also one integral representation, but and also in terms of the Fourier transform functions, here the definition of Fourier transform. But then the function that appears in the Fourier representation of the operator is the inverse of the polynomial. So in some sense, the operator P is associated to the polynomial because it's a partial differential operator, but then the inverse of this operator admit one Fourier representation, but using the inverse of this operator. For instance, this representation says that you require that the denominator, that is the polynomial here, is different of zero for any psi. And because we are working under change of coordinates, here usually we have one error term. This means that the symbol of the function associated to the inverse of one differential operator is the inverse of the polynomial of the operator that you choose, but also you will have in this integral representation one error term. So the question that now arises is that if you find the inverse, the integral representation of the inverse of one differential operator, how to have control on this kind of error terms? How to control this kind of error? Let me say that this error term is one operator, and if you want to minimize, error terms in this sense, you need to precise what minimize means for operators. So the problem of finding inverse of partial differential operator is a hard task, because indeed there is a famous paper by Levy, published in Annals Math, which says that you can find that there exists a differential operator, with a non-constant coefficient without solution. This means that there exists one partial differential operator P in such a way that for one smooth function on Rm, this example is on Rm, you never can find one function U in such a way that U is equal to F. The solution doesn't exist for one specific operator, and this kind of operators exist in view of this kind of examples, like Levy form. So when trying when studying the invertibility of differential operators, then one require conditions on this kind of operators, and this kind of conditions are the ones that one consider in the theory of differential operators. So for now, I just have, just summarizing, I have presented one motivation, and the motivation is that one requires the one a big theory, that is the theory of differential operator, for solving a partial differential equation. And the motivation is to find the inverse of partial differential operators. So now, let me discuss another kind of operator. For example, if you have this kind of equation where P is a differential operator of order m. Assume, for instance, that you can find an exact inverse. Assume that you can't find an exact inverse for this operator, but you can find inverse modulo error terms. Yes. Assume that this operator has this. This property that you can find one continuous linear operator Q in such a way that when you compose Q on the left and on the right, you will get the identity operator plus error terms. If you are talking about this kind of operator, the operators for which this happens, then the following question arises. how to minimize these kind of errors? How to minimize these kind of errors? And like I mentioned before, what minimize means for differential operators? What minimize means for these errors, because these errors are operators. The class of differential operators that satisfy these conditions are exactly a big class in the theory of partial differential equation, that is the class of elliptic operators and hypoelliptic operators. I will not give definition of elliptic operators for now in a complete sense, or hypoelliptic, but just let me say that elliptic operators are those operators such that the polynomial that represent these operators in the Fourier representations are non-zero. Like these ones. Quickly speaking, the class of differential operators, which are elliptic, are those such that the polynomial that represent the operator in the Fourier representations are not zero, is not zero. Okay. So trying to solve this kind of questions for this kind of operator, for those operators that has inverse on the left and on the right, modulo some errors, and that this errors are operators, we need to introduce then a mathematical tool that allow us to minimize these errors, these error operators. Then, these two questions, the question of about how to minimize these errors when finding approximate inverse of differential operators, have an algebraic solution. These two questions have an algebraic solution. And this algebraic solution summarizes, in some sense, the construction of the theory of differential operator. The solution to this problem, more or less, in some words, is the following. You have, for instance, you have the algebra of differential operators. Okay? There you have objects that have having this form, okay? So the idea is to find inverse for these operators, but the inverse of differential operators are not in general differential operators, then they are outside of this class. But then the idea is to construct a big class of operators containing or inverse for these operators, or containing approximate inverse for these operators. And in the theory of partial differential operators, when you construct algebras with these characteristics, then to this algebra, you will call an algebra of pseudo differential operators, thinking that P is a differential operator, but Q, which is an approximate inverse of P inverse, yes? These are linear operators, but are not differential. But they have similar properties like differential operators. So that is the reason because one calls this the algebra of pseudo differential operators. So the question in general is when one can construct this kind of algebras, or for which operator you can construct which kind of algebra. Okay, to talk about the solution or to talk about the construction of this kind of algebras or pseudo differential operator, let me fix some terminology. First, let me denote for one closed manifold, M. A closed manifold is a compact manifold without boundary. And then let me denote by, like here, the class of differential operators of order n. Yes? Like I mentioned before, these are operators that has this representation. in terms of partial derivatives. What partial derivatives means in one manifold? Okay, you have on manifold you have usually you have local coordinate systems because you are in the case of manifolds. You have local coordinate systems. If the dimension of the manifold is n, you can call to these coordinates x1, x2, until xn. If these are coordinates on the manifold, then you can define partial derivatives with respect to these directions. These are differential operators of first order. These operators are characterized by the two algebraic properties. The first one is the Leibniz rule. And the second one is that the partial derivative of the constant functions equal to 1 is 0. These two thoughts characterize these two characteristics in some sense characterize the class of differential operators of order 1. And then if you want to have differential operators of higher order, you only need to make arbitrary composition of these operators. Okay. So returning to the representation of one partial differential operator, which is this in terms of local coordinates, you can consider the great algebra of all differential operators. You can consider the class of differential operators of order m, and then you can take the direct sum of this class, and then you consider this graded algebra. And this algebra is graded in the sense that you have two differential operators, and one of them is of order m, for example, and the second one is of order, let me say, m tilde. Then the composition of these two operators has order m plus m tilde. In this sense, this is a graded algebra. So this step one is just the description of the algebra of differential operator that I was that I did here was to describe the algebra of differential operators on the main. But then the question is how to construct. Question is how to construct the bigger algebra, the algebra that contains inverse of differential operators and of pseudo differential operators. How to construct this algebra? Okay. This algebra, you can construct this algebra using the Fourier transform. You can construct this algebra using the Fourier transform. For example, in the case of Rm, you construct this algebra in the following way. You consider, for example, the definition of the Fourier transform, which is this one. And then you consider this class of symbols. Which are smooth functions on Rm cross Rm to the complex numbers, such that they and the derivatives of these functions grow at least of polynomial order. With this decay in the derivatives. Then one can check that if P belongs to the class of differential operators of order M, then one can show that exactly PXI, which is the polynomial associated to the operator has this form. one can show that this operator belongs to this class, to the class SM. But this class SM has a very nice property. The property is that if you define CM on Rn, like the class of operators, which are continuous and linear, from smooth functions on Rn to smooth functions on Rn, such that these operators are associated in terms of the Fourier transform or to some function sigma, which belongs to the class SM. Here, sigma, one function in the class SM. Sigma in the class SM. Then one can show that, this happens, is that the class of differential operator, the class of differential operators of order M on Rm, are contained in this class. And then the algebra that contains the inverse of some differential operators in these cases, elliptic differential operator in these cases, is this algebra, the direct sum of this. This construction is in the case of Rn, okay? But the construction is similar in the case of a smooth manifold, because the only thing that one needs to do is to use local coordinate systems and to extend using charts these constructions. Okay, so here you have manifolds has local coordinate systems, then you localize this construction, and by a local coordinate system, you can extend this construction on Rn, from Rn to arbitrary compact smooth main. So this construction, which is makes use of the Fourier transform, can be assumed for now to the case of one general compact manifold. And just let me say that always you can find an algebra of continuous linear operators in such a way that this algebra is a graded algebra. This algebra has components of order L. Yes, these are components of order L means that the class for any L, for example, the class of differential operator of order L is included in the component of order L of this algebra. So that I means that the algebra of differential of the class of differential operator of order M is contained in this component. And for those differential operators that admit for the class of differential operator of order M, that the symbol is different of zero in local coordinate system, far from zero, you can find always approximate inverse. So if the order of the operator is M, in this graded algebra that you construct, the order of the inverse is minus M, and you have that the composition on the left of this inverse or approximate inverse will get you the identity operator plus some error terms. And for this always is possible for the operator that has this property. the property that the symbol is different of zero for any size different of zero. So that is important here is that about the question of how to minimize the errors when finding inverse of differential operators, that in this case, E and E tilde, that are the errors in these compositions, belongs to this class, the class psi with the power minus infinity, which is the class of operator that belongs to all the components of the graded algebra of zero differential operators that you construct. Okay? In the case of Rn, for example, in the case of Rn, in the case of Rn, I will write on the left just to describe. In the case of Rn, you have one error operator in the class C with the power minus infinity. It means that your error operator has this integral form. For sort function E at psi. This is the Fourier representation of the error. But then this function belongs to the intersection of all SM classes. These classes that I introduced before. Remember that one function belongs on Rn, one function belongs to the class Sn, if you have this symbol inequalities. You have the symbol inequalities, but if this happens for any m, then you will say that if this happens for any m, this is the class S with the power minus infinity. And for these error terms, it happens that exactly the error terms belongs to this class of functions. So in some sense, that this says is that for any real number, derivatives of arbitrary orders of the symbol associated to the error operator, the case, more bigger than any polynomial. This for any m. For example, typically you can think about, for example, the case of this function. Yes, this is a function that satisfies this kind. And this is the kind of errors that one gets sometimes. Okay. So, summarizing, there exists an algebra. Summarizing, there exists an algebra on compact manifold M. There exists an algebra Cm. This algebra has components of order L with the property that any of these components contains the differential operator of order L. This algebra contains inverts, modulo psi minus infinity. This is the class defined like the intersection of those all these classes. And that is very important here is that this class psi with the power minus infinity, which is the class where all the errors of this inverse are, is a prime ideal of this of the graded algebra. This is an interesting algebraic property. This is this class psi with the power minus infinity is a prime ideal of this graded algebra. And prime ideal in the usual sense, that you have that the product of the composition of this of two operators has this order, then one of them has order minus infinity. So interesting, because if you take then the quotient algebra by the class of elliptic operators, remember that are those that in local coordinates has symbols satisfying this condition, that the symbol doesn't vanish. Then if you consider the quotient algebra, then in this algebra, the class of pseudo-differential, the class of differential operator has a SAT inverse, which means that if you consider the case of P, if P is one elliptic operator, then you can find Q of order minus m, such that the composition of the on the left and on the right produce one error term plus the identity. And in this quotient algebra, in this quotient algebra, P has a SAT inverse, which is a very, very beautiful algebraic property of this construction. Okay, so let me mention quickly how to construct this algebra explicitly in the case of compactly groups, because we are talking about manifolds. M is one manifold. But then what happens, or how to construct the algebra of pseudo-differential operators in the case when M is a compactly group? Okay, that is important in the case of compactly groups, is that because you are talking about groups, then you maybe have a rich representation theory of groups. So maybe one can use the representation theory of groups to construct the algebra of differential operators. So this indeed is the question, central question here. How to construct the algebra of pseudo-differential operator CM without using local coordinate systems? If you see in the past constructions, several times I use the Fourier transform. I use that for the case of Rm. I use it for the construction of that algebra in the case of Rm. I use the Fourier transform. And then I mentioned that using a local coordinate system here, in the construction of this algebra, one used the Fourier transform of functions, yes? But then if you think about the manifolds, then you localize this construction, you use local coordinate systems to extend this construction to the case of arbitrary compact manifolds. But the question is, if you can construct the algebra of the differential operator without using local coordinate systems, the answer is yes, there are several constructions. And this is important because usually the notation of this kind of things are of numerical type, are of numerical nature. For example, if you are talking about one differential operator and you are in the case of one manifold, for example, SU2 or the torus, then these are manifolds. And if you consider the problem of the invertibility of this operator with the classical construction, you need to manage the Fourier transform and their change of coordinates. And from the computational point of view, this has a high complexity. So the question is how to eliminate the construction using local coordinate systems and using the Euclidean Fourier transform for the general algebra of differential operators. So here you find four articles where the author asks about how to construct differential operator without using local coordinate systems. This kind of constructions are very important in physics, for example, when studying the invertibility of differential operators that are of relevant interest there, that are the Laplacian of the Dirac operator. And then they need to study the invertibility of this operator without using the Euclidean Fourier transform. So that Michael Ruchansky and Billy Turunen discovered some years ago is that one can use the construction, or one can construct the algebra of differential operators using the representation theory of groups if your manifold is one compactly groups. There is a book dedicated to the construction of this theory, which is this book, Pseudo-Differential Operators and Symmetry, where you will find with more details the construction that I will mention some basic here. So for instance, to show you how to construct the algebra in the case of compactly groups, let me fit, for instance, one Lie group. This means that you have one smooth manifold, and this smooth manifold has an smooth structure which is compatible with the group structure. Examples are Lie groups of matrices, for example. This group of matrices. So let me fit some notation. Let me fit equal to G, one compactly group. For the constructions of the algebra of pseudo-differential operators, we will use the representation theory of compactly groups. So let me define what is a unitary representation of the group. A unitary representation then is a continuum mapping from the group to some space of unitary operators on some finite dimensional. For instance, we are talking about compact spaces. So this we just can represent Lie groups in finite dimensional spaces. So in general, one says that one representation is one map from G to the space of unitary operator on one Hilbert space, but because the group is compact, then this Hilbert space always has a finite dimension. So the dimension of the representational space always is finite in the case of compactly groups. And then one always can think about this power of the complex number while thinking in representation spaces of compactly groups. So you will say that that one representation is unitary if the representation is continuous. And because it is an homomorphism, then you have these properties. And let me denote by this I the dimension of the representation space. This here is the representation space. So you have, or you will say that the two representations are equivalent. If you have, for any x, you have that the representations, you can pass from one representation to the another one using one change of basis, which is says this this equation. And then this definition that two representations are equivalent, this defined sorry. If you have two representations, psi and eta, representation of the group, if they are equivalents, then you have one equivalence relation, and then consider the quotient of this of the space of representation of the space of unitary representations with respect to this equivalence relation. Then to this space you will denote g hat, and this g hat consists of equivalent classes of continuous and irreducible unitary representation of the group. So, because the group is compact, then the unitary dual, which is g hat, unitary dual, is discrete. It's discrete. And then, in terms of the representation, you can use the Fourier transform. You can define the Fourier transform, but this is not the Euclidean Fourier transform. This is the Fourier transform of the group. So, see, you consider one representation on the group. You know that C of X is an unitary operator. If you have this identification, then you can think about this unitary operator like a matrix of size decide. And then for any smooth function, you define the Fourier transform using this integral form. You evaluate the Fourier transform in this context at the representations. And this is just the integral of the function multiplying by the corresponding star of the representation, yes? Because the representation is unitary, then psi star is the inverse of psi of x. And this Fourier transform has the property that you can reconstruct functions using the Fourier transform. So for any functions, this is an operator. This is an operator between these two spaces. Also, psi of x is one operator between these two spaces. And if you consider the composition is well defined, and you take the trace of that operator, this is the trace of matrices in finite dimension, and if you consider these series reconstruct exactly the function. This result, for example, if the function is smooth, is known like the Fourier inversion formula. Okay, like you can imagine, is that if in terms of compactly groups, you have representations, and in terms of the representations, you can define the Fourier transform, then you can define pseudo-differential operators using also this Fourier transform of the group. And this indeed happens. This is the central observation of Ruchansky and Turunen. They say, okay, you have one continuous linear operator. One can use some results from analysis to represent these operators in integral form. For instance, any continuous linear operator admit this integral representation. This is exactly the Schwarz kernel theorem in this context. Then to the operator, you associate one kernel function. And if for any x, you define, you make this definition. You consider, this is the kernel, this is the kernel associated to the operator, but if you change the notation a little here, you can rewrite this equation in this form. And then you can represent this operator in terms of this somehow convolution kernel for the operator. This Kx is somehow one convolution kernel of the operator. convolution kernel of the operator. And always, using the Schwarz kernel theorem, to any operator, you can associate this convolution kernel, and then the central theorem of Ruchansky-Turunen says that you can represent one operator in terms of the Fourier transform on the group using one function, sigma. And this function, sigma, is exactly the Fourier transform of the right convolution kernel, which is this. This is the hard measure on the group. So this central theorem of Ruchansky and Turunen, that you can represent continuous linear operators using the Fourier transform in terms of one specific function, is called the quantization formula of compactly groups here. Okay, I think that time is over. I just let me finish in 5 minutes. Just mention that, like you can imagine, if you study, if you want to study properties of the operator, you can study properties of the operator using properties of the symbol. For example, if you have one continuous linear operator in the case of one compactly group, and for any xi, the matrix symbol, sigma xi, this is a matrix. If this matrix is invertible, then you will get that the operator is also invertible modulo errors that belongs to a suitable class of errors, of suitable class of pseudo-differential operators. So thinking about the invertibility of differential operators, one can say that A is invertible if, quickly speaking, for example, the symbol that you construct using the Fourier transform, this symbol, for any x and for any psi, this is a mapping between two representation space. If this symbol is invertible for almost for infinite classes of equivalent representation with the exception of finite quantity of them, then you will construct inverts for this kind of operators on the left and on the right. Okay, so that I wanted to put in perspective today was that you have two constructions. One construction for differential, for the algebra of pseudo-differential operators using this, using the Fourier transform, the Euclidean Fourier transform, the Fourier transform on Rn. And in the case of compactly groups, you can use representations, elements of the unitary dual of one compactly group, to represent the operator in terms of the Fourier transform of the group. And that in this case, this element here that depends only of the group structure and of the representation theory of the group can be used to study the properties of the operator. For instance, if you have an special decay, you have an special decay of the operator. If this operator norm is small enough, which means that, for example, you can compare this in some sense, for example, with the eigenvalues of the Laplacian in this context, because you are in a compactly group, you have one Laplacian of the group. This Laplacian has eigenvalues. And for example, here you have that the operator norm of the matrix associated to one continuous linear operator A satisfy this kind of estimates for any M. One can show that then the operator A from L2 to L2 is of trust class, which means that the operator has a countable system of eigenvalues, and that you can rewrite, for example, the trace of the operator in terms of the global symbol, in terms of the symbol that you construct using the representation theory of the group. So on the left, you have spectral information, which is the trace of one operator. And on the right, you have this spectral information writer in terms of the representation theory of the group. So these are essentially the kind of the applications that one has when one considers this construction of algebras using the representation theory of the group. Maybe you can make a description of the properties of the operator without using local coordinate systems. So I think that I will stop for now. I am open for questions.